welcome to another edition of Fintech Focus. Today I have Mahmoud Noorani, the founder and CEO of Quant Insight. Welcome, Mahmoud. Thank you very much for joining us. Very excited to have you here. So Quant Insight is a quant macro data analytics company. Maybe if you start with telling us a bit more about what you do there.
Absolutely. Our core belief is that investing is increasingly becoming about the analysis of data and less driven by hunches, subjective analysis, opinions. We started this by way of background. The founders of QI all come from the buy side. We were portfolio managers at primarily macro, but other hedge funds. And around 2011, we became convinced that the world is becoming much more complicated. The sheer number of influences on asset markets has proliferated. And we now have things that we need to watch, like China and the whole emerging market complex, quantitative easing, quantitative tightening, sovereign stress in Southern Europe, the rise of the importance of the energy and commodity complex, emerging market vol, banking sector stress. And so it's not just about what a monetary policymaker is going to do next. There are dozens of influences. In addition to that, the world has become far more interconnected, and asset classes have become far more interconnected. So if you're a fixed income trader, you now need to keep an eye on the FX market, on the credit market, on equity markets, on geopolitical risk. So this explosion of complexity, on the one hand, combined with a sort of growing amount of available data, is what motivated us to try and create a framework to sort of understand what's going on under the surface. And so we started working with academics at Cambridge, Harvard, combined their world-class quantitative expertise with our understanding of how markets work, to create a product that essentially gives transparency and takes a scientific approach to helping investors understand what's going on in markets.
Because the market is getting so much more complex alongside the amount of data that people are accessible to. It's about making it easier for people to understand, I suppose.
Yes, and look, I think even 10 years ago, the problem was there is too much information. Even 15 years ago, the amount of information a portfolio manager and investor has access to is mind-boggling. And one of the strange things about fintech for investors is that that problem of too much information has gotten worse, because the alternative data space now gives you access to all types of new data sources: credit card information, satellite images, you know, geopolitical risk measures. There's just a huge amount, you know, there's lots of firms that scrape social media and Twitter and give you sentiment indices. So we've gone from a problem of too much information to, well, hold on, it's exploded even more. So QI is a bit different, because what we are essentially trying to do is provide a set of quantitative techniques that bring all this information together and gives you some insight into what's going on in this very large data. What are the patterns under the surface? How do we get insight from information? There's kind of three stages. There's raw data. You can then look at that data and start thinking about it, and it becomes information. But in order to get insight, you need to bring it all together. So we're slightly different in that we're not providing yet more data. We are providing a platform that helps you make sense of the data you already have, which is probably too much anyway.
Yeah. And your tagline, more science, less opinion, I love that. Tell us more about that.
Well, when we started off in late 2014, we started looking at what was then the research industry. And I don't remember the exact numbers, but the sheer millions of pages of PDFs that were produced by banks and independent research firms.
Imagine.
And there's some statistics out there that something like 1% of those are actually read. The rest is all deleted.
Just 1%?
Just about 1%. Yeah. And so what was frustrating us, and we were consumers of that information for a long period of time, was that you know, everybody has a different opinion. All opinions are valid, and maybe none of them are valid at the same time. How do you actually get some objective analysis of actual hard data? And so when we try to really think about what QI really stands for, what we're really about is bringing scientific techniques to the analysis of financial markets and to investing generally. And we can see that there are more and more systematic funds out there leveraging the incredibly cheap processing power. It's amazing how cheap processing power now is. We have something like 1,000 processors running in parallel in a data center. It really costs you. Could never have done that 10 years ago. There are a lot of techniques that have been around a long time, and we can now use this processing power to actually provide hard evidence to help investors make better decisions. So for us, it was trying to move away from that subjective kind of intuition-based investing and more towards, look, here are some hard facts that'll help you understand what's going on. And if you understand what's going on, the odds are you'll make better informed decisions.
Yeah, that's excellent. So you mentioned there the need for quant analytics. You mentioned what makes you different. Is there anything else that you'd add that makes you different to people in the marketplace that are doing things similar?
Well, I think that one of the... We have a bit of an advantage in that we started pretty early. And so our product was out there by 2016. By the end of 2018, we had something like 170 subscribers across some of the world's biggest financial institutions and banks and hedge funds and pension funds and insurance companies. And so we learned that the way analysis is delivered, we needed to change the way we delivered it. And we started off with a web-based platform. Mm-hmm. You get your username, you get your password, you log in, you look at some instruments. You know, I want to look at Apple stock and look at the QI analysis on that or whatever it is. And what we found is that users really do not want yet another username and password and yet another website to log into. And so we spent pretty much all of 2018 rebuilding everything in the cloud and developing an API that we released in February this year. And the power of that is that we can now pipe our data straight into the environment of our clients, and then they can use that data to add to their existing analytics. Mm-hmm. And that has a lot of advantages for us. Number one, it makes us stickier. One of the things we found about signing up a single portfolio manager to QI is that there's turnover and there's churn. And when a portfolio manager leaves the fund, our subscription is cancelled. Now, maybe 3 months later, they sign up somewhere else. But overall, that universe of PMs is shrinking. If you actually deliver your data via API and it gets integrated into the client's risk reports and various analytic reports, you're kind of there to stay. You become part of the infrastructure. The other shift we found is that we spent the first 2 years doing a fair bit of writing around what the quantitative framework was telling us. So we would write highlights every week. And the problem with that was that it sort of started to move us into the research bucket because we were putting our interpretation between the output we had and what the client saw. And we've now removed that. We've simplified the output so that clients can look at what we produce and instantly get it. So we're simplifying. And that means we're more on the kind of data analytics side, not really on the research side. Mm-hmm. We're more on, and you know, the API fits that perfectly. And the other business advantage of that is the budgets. When you look at hedge funds and asset managers, pension funds, the amount of money they're spending on analytics is growing. the amount of money they're spending on research is shrinking. So I think we're in the right space, and kind of, you know, the we've got what were initially headwinds, we've sort of turned the business to a slightly different direction, and we now have a lot of tailwinds, which is great.
Yeah, and it seems like you're responding to market needs and what people are saying that they want out there. I definitely agree with the one less password is a good thing.
Absolutely. It's that, you know, there's too much information, there's too many platforms.
Yeah.
And what's happening now is there's a whole streamlining process going on. And firms are going more and more for kind of firm-wide API-based analytics products. Mm-hmm. And so we're fortunate in that we have a very top-notch technology partner, a firm called Whitespace. Mm-hmm. They are a London-based firm that is a technology accelerator, founded by a chap called Andrew McCartney, who was CIO of Microsoft Ventures.
Wow.
And so we've had great advice from them, and I think the conversation started over 2 years ago, that the future is data via API in the cloud, scalable, flexible, very low fixed cost. I mean, if you go back 10 years ago and you wanted to do this, you'd have to go and buy lots of servers. You don't need to do that anymore. Mm-hmm. You just put everything in the cloud.
Yeah.
So I think from the technology side, we're exactly where we want to be now.
Yeah. So where does Quant Insight fit into the alternative data space at the moment?
So the alternative data space is dominated by providers of pretty much single different types of time series.
Mm-hmm.
And what funds will go and do is they will say, okay, let's have a look if this data we can get on credit card expenditure from a big credit card company can predict US GDP or what the S&P 500 is going to do. Let's go and take satellite image data of kind of Walmart car parks and how full they are, and see if that can give us an early read on what Walmart sales are going to be this quarter.
Mm-hmm.
Let's go and take data from Twitter and other social media and see if, you know, the sentiment around a particular stock can predict what that stock will do tomorrow or in a week. The net result of that effort is there is no single time series or signal that can consistently generate profit. It doesn't exist. And even if it does exist, its life is very short-lived, because once people cotton on that, you know, this is a predictor of a price, it stops being effective.
Once everyone knows, the
effect is gone. We are not in that space. In fact, I read an interesting piece last week that the head of data science at a major global bank just released the results of testing 700 alternative data series and concluded that there was no alpha in any one of those 700 data series. What we're doing is saying we've actually got enough data, quality data. When you combine it all, that's where the alpha is.
Mm-hmm.
So is there something from a combination of all this data that helps you understand what is driving asset prices and what they're going to do next? The fact of the matter is that predicting price is very difficult. And our take is that in order to predict the price, the first thing you've got to do is understand what drives the price. If you have no idea what the price is trading off, it's really hard to predict the price. A great example is, I remember late 2014, all the kind of big banks were putting out their 2015 outlook pieces, and they were going with the view that profits in the US as a percentage of GDP were at an all-time high. Profits would have to go down in 2015, and if profits went down, the S&P 500 would probably go down, so they were bearish.
Mm.
The problem is that when we looked at our analytics, they were telling us that actually the S&P 500 didn't actually care about company profits. The only thing it cared about was US monetary policy, cheap money. And so if a portfolio manager was able to realize that actually equities are trading off monetary policy, not off earnings, then the next step would be, well, what's my view on monetary policy? Is it going to stay easy? Are we going to have more QE? If we are, then equities are probably going to go up. So we're sort of trying to combine all this data to help investors understand what's driving the price. And once they understand what's driving the price, then they have a bit more of a chance of predicting what the price is going to do next. Yeah. So we're in the business of bringing information together in order to convert it into valuable insight.
Yeah, great. And you mentioned before we started recording a bit about machine learning. Do you want to talk a bit about that?
Yes, and you know, one of the sort of frustrating things in the industry is that there's so much talk of artificial intelligence and machine learning.
It's everywhere at the moment.
It's absolutely everywhere. And I think
semantic as well.
Yeah, and it just causes a lot of confusion, you know. And there's a lot of jokes going around that, you know, when you're out talking to investors, you've got to use AI in there somewhere. Mm. And when you're actually kind of, you know, in practice doing analysis, it's just sort of standard statistical techniques with these fancy names. The essence of machine learning essentially is that a framework that takes information, processes that information, and is continuously adapting and finding patterns within that information. Mm-hmm. The fact of the matter is, however, that machine learning techniques have been around for maybe 100 years. Mm. What makes today different is, in my view, the fact that processing power is so cheap that these techniques can, and that the amount of data is so enormous, that with that processing power and the data and these 100-year-old techniques, you can create something valuable. But it's not the techniques themselves that are the secret. They've been around forever. Even neural networks have been around for a very long time. There are probably very few genuine advances that have happened in the last, let's say, 15 years in how neural networks are designed and the research
behind it. Just the speed of it and the accessibility, isn't it?
It's speed, it's processing power, it's the fact everything's connected via API and the cloud. And so you can do a lot more, but it's not the case that there's some secret new technique that a few people have called machine learning or AI. Yeah. That's not it.
Yeah, that's really interesting to know. So thank you so much for joining us. If you'd like to speak to Mahmoud, please follow the link that's underneath this video or underneath the podcast list. So please remember, more science, less opinion. Thanks, Mahmoud, for your time.
Thank you very much.
Cheers.